Returning east to the primitive shrine, we next tried the hallway leading northwest and into an open doorway. Peering into this old chamber, my first impression was that it was once a bedroom. However, everything had recently been smashed to pieces, all the furniture not just ruined but utterly torn apart. Now, much of the debris had been pulled together into the northwestern corner, creating some sort of lair or large nest. Strongly suspecting that the debris was inhabited by something, we waited a few minutes to see if we detected any movement or sound. As most of the debris and large nest was in the far northwestern corner, we could probably avoid anything dwelling within if we stayed to the hallway and merely passed through the chamber. Or, of course, we could tempt fate and further explore the debris in the corner, almost certainly drawing the attention of whatever lurked within. What to try? Electing to cautiously explore the nest, I signaled to the party to slowly approach the lair in the corner. As we neared to within 10 feet of the primary nest entrance, I then heard a small roar, followed by a puff of fire. We had seen this before, back in the death crypt of Khaldun, it appeared at least one hellhound was here. While my impulse was to assault the lair violently or even set fire to the lair and be done with it, I urged my heroes to stand fast and, weapons ready, wait to see what may actually exit the lair. Another tiny roar was heard, followed by more spits of fire. Yep, definitely a hellhound inside. Expecting the worst, a puppy-like head then emerged, its yellow eyes betraying its demonic lineage. Yet the creature was quite small, and while it growled at our party, it certainly was no real threat. By thunder, it's a hellhound pup. Red Fern was the first to comment, almost wondrous by the find. That's a demonic creature, Sainaeus warned, preparing to slay the tiny beast. It should be destroyed. It is possible to befriend such a pup, Red Fern returned, more curious. It may behave itself if exposed to my magic. That does not sound like a good idea, Eswin warned, siding with Sainaeus. Let's cull the monster and move on. As if reading my mind, Red Fern grinned and retrieved a little of his rations, setting it down on the ground a few feet away from the hellhound pup. It took a little while, but eventually the tiny creature ever so slowly approached the food. The hellhound was definitely hungry. The pup sniffed the food several times and even tasted it, but the rations were for people, not hellhound puppies. Recognizing this, Red Fern turned and left the party, heading southeast and letting us know he would be right back. Minutes later, Red Fern returned, carrying a small, bloody bag. He approached the hellhound pup again, then withdrew a bit of flesh from one of the infernals we had defeated back in the Hall of Victory. The meat was quite disgusting, but we watched in stunned fascination as Red Fern laid it down before the pup, and it quickly started devouring the meat. 10 minutes later, the hellhound was sated and Red Fern picked the creature up, having won its trust. Oh, it appeared that Red Fern intended to actually keep the animal. Surprised by the entire encounter, Red Fern had made a friend. Who knew how this might work out, but for now I was okay with allowing Red Fern to keep the animal. Following the hallway northeast and soon arriving in a large room, we peered into the grisly chamber. Dominating the room were a variety of torture machines, fiendish devices meant to inflict agony, terror, and death upon those unlucky enough to be secured to them. Nearly a dozen such machines lay about, many of them covered in blood and a few still bearing the corpses of their latest victims. It was an appalling sight and I wanted to retreat. We then spotted movement from the far corner and heard a faint woman's cry. Slowly approaching, we found a monstrous infernal standing 30 feet away, the winged creature made of fire and darkness, and something we had never encountered before. The creature was quite intimidating, something I suspected could stand against our party all by itself. Holding a glowing whip, it was standing alongside a robed humanoid sitting at a table, an apparent ultimate who was riding something, the monster peering over her shoulder. I heard a few more sobs from the ultimate, an older woman's voice that sounded frail and very hurt, and my instinct was to rush in and rescue her. Somewhere recently, I recalled someone talking about infernals that were extremely powerful and among the most dishonorable and cruelest of their kind. Known as a Vega, it appeared we had encountered one, and I suspected it was the deadliest infernal we had come across yet. Continuing to watch, the female ultimate finished what she was writing. The infernal taunted her to continue, and she slowly and painfully weaved a spell, enchanting the scroll she had been working on. The infernal huffed, then grabbed the scroll away from the woman, pushing her aside. I had seen enough, it was time to act. Back away from the ultimate, fiend. I bravely called out, taking both the woman and the monster by surprise. Bah. Another ultimate it seems. The infernal cried, his voice deep and heavy. were the ones who defeated all your allies, Eswin boasted, readying his weapon. Is that a challenge? The monster asked, not taking our party seriously. I got what I want, but I have time to crack your skulls and bleed you all over the floor. The Infernal engaged with our party, the Ultimate saw her chance and attempted to flee. As she darted away, however, the monster cracked his whip and attacked her, deriving joy from her intense pain. I don't think so. The woman rushed toward Darius and reached for him. A moment later, the Infernal unleashed his deadly whip attack, the whip encircled the woman and the demon pulled her back, the Ultimate screaming in terror. The Infernal then cast fire all about himself, causing the woman to erupt in flames and killing her quickly. Magical fire pulsed all around the Infernal, tremendous heat that would immediately burn us if we got too close. The monster laughed, a deep, wretched bellow, then snapped his whip again as he approached, joined by three additional vrocks and about to engage all of us in fierce combat. After casting a darkness spell that snuffed out all light within the encounter area, the Vega attacked Eswin with its whip, ensnaring the warrior and drawing him into the flames surrounding the monster, burning Eswin and requiring some immediate healing by Kartha. Sainaeers then cast Spiritual Hammer on the Vega, but the magic had no effect on the demon, the spell fizzling out. In return, one of the Vrocks attacked Sainaeers, forcing the cleric to abandon spell use and attack in hand-to-hand combat. Redfern tried using his wand of lightning bolts, electrocuting not just the Vega but the Vrocks as well. However, the electricity only seemed to do half damage against the Vega, the Infernal apparently resistant to electricity as well. Soon, however, we destroyed the three Vrocks and managed to defeat the Vega as well. Bleeding profusely, the Vega seemed to actually enjoy the pain, grinning wide enough to expose its sharp teeth as it put away its whip, about to depart. That was exhilarating. The Vega called out. But it's time I resurrected my bride. And with that, the Infernal beat his damaged wings and lifted into the air, slipping past our party and quickly exiting through the corridor back to the southeast. Part of me was glad to see the monster escape and part of me wanted to hunt the demon down and finish the job we had started here. The encounter with the Vega apparently over, there was little more we could do amongst all the torture devices and we continued on our way to the southeast. Continuing from the northwest, the small chamber here appeared to have been a study, with several bookshelves lining the northern and western walls. However, all the bookshelves had been knocked over and hundreds of books lay about in a jumbled heap on the floor. Hence, there didn't seem to be much to explore here. Deciding to lift several of the bookshelves up and search the pile of books in the center of the study anyway, it didn't take long before we discovered the corpse of an ultimate, an older human woman who apparently was slain here and then buried in the books. Given the way the corpse's head was twisted in the debris, I suspected that the bookshelves were pushed atop her and she broke her neck. Of course, I couldn't really be sure unless we searched the body directly. These books seem to record the coming and going of prisoners down here, Redfern announced after sifting through several of the records, most of them in decent enough shape. I am guessing there must be some sort of prison or jail cells down here. What about the woman? Kartha asked, glancing at the ultimate. It looks like she died recently. Giving the corpse a thorough search, it was clear that her neck was broken, although we couldn't tell whether she received the injury before or after the bookshelves were toppled upon her. While the body didn't possess any treasure, we did find a small book tightly clutched in her left hand, she likely died trying to protect it. Eswin retrieved the notebook and handed it to Redfern. By thunder! Redfern exclaimed after several moments of paging through the book. These magical words are hard to decipher, but I think the book is all about the one plant. Don't read any more of it. Darius surprisingly commanded, reaching for the book. The ultimates would often bind a horrible curse into the magical words, unless you speak a special password, the book could wipe your mind, electrocute you or do something else dire. Let me have it. Yes, the words of Darius seemed quite reasonable and I was glad he was here to warn us of such things. Redfern acknowledged the warning from Darius and immediately closed it, thankful that nothing bad had happened to him. About to hand the notebook to Darius, Redfern then looked to me for an appropriate response. In full agreement with Darius, I nodded to Redfern to continue, the wizard handing the ex-ultimate the notebook moments later and that was that. While the southern hallway here would return us to the Hall of Victory, we instead followed the tunnel east, soon arriving at a heavily attacked door that was nearly pulled off its hinges and allowed for passage beyond. Stepping through the doorway, we entered a modest armory, all sorts of weapons, armor, shields and ammunition carefully stacked, shelved, and otherwise stowed away. All of it looked to be in excellent shape and I suspected that there may even be some magical items here. Curiously, several large, heavy, metal chains lay across the floor. Wanting to search the armory, our heroes stepped forward and began to look around. Moments later, the heavy chains lying on the floor began to move around, as if they had a mind of their own. Retreating to the chamber's entrance, we watched with surprise as the chains rose into the air to form a roughly humanoid figure, something we had never seen before. I suspect that's some sort of golem, Darius was the first to comment, quite concerned. It's driven by the essence of a trapped air elemental, if we get too close, it will attack with everything it has. And it looks like those chains do a lot of damage, Eswin added, keeping his distance. So, what do we do? Kartha asked, her gaze transfixed on the animated chains ahead. It's likely protecting the armory here, Red Fern answered. Our options are limited. Believing that the potential treasure beyond was worth the pain, I commanded my heroes forward. As we invaded the armory, the animated chains whirled and flew about, three of the chains being used as very lethal weapons against our party. Perfectly resembling a large amount of regular chain made from various metals, chain golems stand about 15 feet tall and weigh up to 3,000 pounds, lashing out with several long chains that do tremendous damage each, and constricting those who are hit for several long moments. As a single hit from the monster was enough to knock even Eswin unconscious, most of us kept our distance, trying our missile weapons against it, which proved all but ineffective. Magic, too, was ineffective, the golem apparently immune to all kinds of magic. Hence, all we could do was wail away at the monster, slowly wearing it down while constantly reviving those heroes who were struck and knocked out by the heavy chains. Some 20 minutes later, we finally destroyed the trapped air elemental animating the heavy chains and thousands of pounds of metal crashed to the floor, the noise loud enough to wake the dead. The chains now lying silently across the cold stone floor, we were able to move forward and search the armory to our heart's content, spending nearly an hour to recover as much as we could. Inside several barrels were hundreds of rounds of ammunition, including some magical arrows and even some poisoned darts. One chest yielded a sling plus 2 and a warhammer plus 2, a hidden sack contained 50 rounds of ammunition plus 2, a weapons rack stored a great axe plus 1 and a heavy crossbow plus 1, while some crates held a metallic shield plus 2 and plate mail plus 1, along with hundreds of non-magical arms and armor. Hence, the combat with the chain golem was well worth the plunder we had found, and nearly everyone in my party was able to improve their arms and armor in some way. The ultimate armory raided, it was time to move on. A single hallway led back the way we had come to the west. The second floor of the dungeon now fully explored, we weren't sure at first where to go next. Recalling that the Vega wanted to resurrect his bride, however, we decided to return to the tomb containing the corpse of the succubus. Hence, we weren't surprised to find the Vega encountered back within the torture chamber to the northwest, the monster just now completing the reciting of the raised dead scroll provided by the ultimate cleric. Readying our weapons for imminent combat, the succubus stirred, embraced the Vega, almost as if they were lovers and then crawled out of the crude sarcophagus, the pair very happy to be alongside one another again. The Vega and succubus watched as we approached, the two infernals eyeing us with a smugness as if they knew something we did not. You can't stop us, the Vega announced, readying his whip again. And after you're dead, we will finally escape this wretched dungeon and lay waste to your world. There is only two of you and all of us, Eswin responded, confident of our chances. Well, see about that, the succubus hissed, her eerie voice juxtaposed to her physical beauty. The Vega grinned and snapped its demonic fingers. Immediately, the wall of corpses lying against the western wall animated, falling over themselves but quickly regaining their feet, about to assist the two infernals in their fight against us. Surprised by the turn of events, I counted over 24 zombies as they slowly approached. Now, let's see who is stronger, the Vega taunted, readying his whip. To the death. And with that, the demons and zombies attacked. Acting quickly, Sanaeus and Kartha were able to turn undead, chasing roughly half the zombies into the far corner where they wouldn't bother us again. While the Vega proved to be quite the challenge again, this time at least we knew how to fight and defend against it. The succubus was the wild card in the mix, the demon something we had never faced before. Red Fern tried lightning against the infernal but she was apparently immune to it. In turn, the succubus attacked not only with two claws but a kiss, each one capable of charming one of my heroes into standing down and exiting the battle. Hence, the Vega and the succubus proved to be quite the challenge together. Eventually, however, we managed to defeat both. Nearly slain, the Vega fell alongside the succubus, the two kissed one another one last time, then slumped to the ground together in death. My party cautiously approached the defeated infernals, the pair still embracing one another even in death. Moments later, their bodies began to decay, soon dissolving into nothingness. Their time within Sisalus had definitely come to an end. I hope that puts an end to these infernals here within the dungeon, Karthus stated, tired of them. The ultimates were fools to summon them in the first place. What's that? Red Fern asked, pointing toward a small hole in the western wall about 20 feet away. Peering forward, we noticed a small hole in the wall, just a few inches in diameter, and I led the party to the hole, absolute darkness beyond. Intrigued, Red Fern retrieved one of his daggers and slowly stuck the blade into the hole, able to push its entire length through. We had apparently found a false wall here. Nodding affirmatively to Eswin, the mighty warrior used the pummel of his own weapon to smash into the wall, expanding the width of the hole and revealing open darkness beyond. The rest of the party joining Eswin, we soon cleared enough of the wall to reveal old, dusty, crumbling stairs leading down. Apparently, the doorway here had been plastered over many years ago, forming a false wall. Now through, we had discovered a way down to an even lower level of the dungeon. A way down, Eswin commented matter-of-factly. Perhaps it was best we fought the infernals here after all. Shining some light through the wall, the stairs descended a good 30 feet before terminating in what appeared to be a cave-in below. The breach in the wall here discovered and opened enough to permit entry. We could now descend to the third level of the dungeon from here. First, however, we decided to make camp, heal our wounds, recover our spells and prepare ourselves for whatever awaited us on the third level of the dungeon. The next morning, we descended into the collapsed hallway from above, taking a few hours to clear the debris and make our way into the hallway below. The work was slow, dirty, and dangerous, but it appeared to be the only way for us to penetrate the third level of the dungeon. Working cautiously as well as patiently, we eventually cleared enough of the wreckage to climb down into the hallway below, and without causing the ceiling to further collapse. We were in. I am guessing this part of the dungeon was sealed off decades ago, Darius began, the first of us to speak in a while. We were lucky to find this way down. Sometimes luck is more valuable than skill, Red Fern commented with a grin. Hopefully our luck will continue. My heroes nodded in agreement, grateful to have come this far. Enough of the debris now cleared away to proceed, we turned north, the only direction we could travel. Passing through the southern door, we entered a chamber roughly 20 feet to a side and bathed in magical light, its brilliance almost blinding. Apart from additional doors to the west and north, however, there was absolutely nothing else within the room. This isn't just magical light, Sainayers began, sensing the light with his hands and face and recognizing what it was. It's some sort of holy light meant to protect against undead. Yes, I feel it too, Kartha agreed, the light warm and almost sensual. We need to beware. With nothing more to do here, we needed to move on. Apart from the southern door we had just come through, additional doors awaited to the west and north. Following the hallway west, we soon entered a small chamber containing six metal plaques on the walls, two to the north, two to the west and two to the south. Each plaque was only 2 feet across by 3 feet in height, the pair of plaques in each wall positioned next to one another. Nothing else was visible within the dusty chamber. Giving the area a quick search, it was clear that we had entered a crypt, the names and family crests of the deceased etched into each of the small metal plaques. Experience warned me that we shouldn't stay here long, lest something crawl out of these walls and attack. Recognizing the smart thing to do, our party agreed to retreat to the brilliantly lit room to the east, escaping this chamber before anything unpleasant happened. Following a single hallway north and reaching an unlocked door, all we could see inside was a glowing, silvery blue mist beyond, so thick that we could not see anything else. The strange mist began to flow out of the opened door. Standing within it, we didn't feel anything other than a little cold. What is this? Eswin asked, concerned. I don't know, Darius offered, surprising me. My intuition was telling me that the chamber ahead seemed dangerous. I didn't like the idea of stepping foot into it at all. However, it also seemed like we didn't have much choice. Nodding to Eswin, he slowly led our party into the strange, glowing chamber. The mist dominated the room here, so thick we couldn't see anything. Feeling about, I didn't touch anything either, apart from the walls and doors that stood in all four cardinal directions, there was nothing in here. However, I then started feeling a little lightheaded. Redfern also reported that he was sensing some magic here, so we needed to be very careful if we remained within the chamber. Despite the dizziness, our party continued to explore the misty chamber. Soon, I recognized that the northern, eastern, and southern doors were all unlocked, but the western door was more than locked, it was likely magically sealed. Hence, if we wanted to go west, we would need to figure out how to deal with the door. The dizziness started getting worse and I realized that we would need to either leave now or potentially risk becoming ill from the glowing mist. Hence, I fumbled for the door leading east and we quickly exited the misty chamber. Following a lone hallway east, we soon came across an unguarded stone stairway leading up. This is the stairway that leads back up into that disintegration field we found, Darius calmly explained, recognizing where we were. We definitely cannot ascend the dungeon from here, we will need another way out when the time comes. The stairway investigated, and determined to be far too dangerous to use, we needed to retreat west the way we came. Indeed, we returned to the Hall of Mists but quickly tried the northern door to see where that may lead. Escaping the Chamber of Mists to the south, we entered a small stone room, a natural cavern with no other apparent exits. Dominating the center of the room was a large water well, some sort of machine used to pump the water out, resting just above the well alongside a large tunnel dug directly into the bedrock leading horizontally to the west. Several flexible hoses lay alongside the well. A quick inspection of the chamber didn't reveal anything we hadn't already noticed. The room was clearly dedicated to the well and the extraction of water from below. Inspecting the tunnel leading into the bedrock, it appeared that once water was brought to the surface, it could easily be pumped into the tunnel and channeled to somewhere beyond the western wall. Given that the wall looked quite solid and secure, however, we couldn't determine the water's destination from here. Given the tunnel, I suspect the Ultimates have a strong need for water to the west, Redfern announced. Perhaps they're growing something down here? Kartha suggested, recognizing what copious amounts of water could be used for. Maybe the one plant is near? My heroes nodded, both suggestions highly plausible. Unfortunately, there was nothing more we could do within the chamber, meaning that our only option at this point was to return to the Hall of Mists and try to somehow get through the western door. And that's a wrap of episode number 43, Gep Power Tower Dungeon Part 3. Expect additional episodes every few weeks as the story continues.